just ahead on CTV News.
Jury selection underway today in the trial of a woman accused of brutally murdering her mother. Got that story coming up on CTV News.
Plus, Councilman Calvin Hawkins hosts a community business roundtable. And super cybersecurity grandma visits Bowie State University. Those stories and more on CTV News starting now.
This is CTV News for October 23rd. I'm Katara Jones.
And I'm Michaela Newton. Thanks so much for joining us. Now, we are less than 2 weeks away from Election Day, and Democratic candidate for Senate Angela Alsobrooks has headed into the final stretch of her campaign. Now, although there are twice as many registered Democrats than Republicans in the state, experts say the race between former Governor Larry Hogan and Alsobrooks is closer than anticipated. Now, early voting in Maryland starts tomorrow and will run until October 31st. Prince George's County residents can stop by any of the following sites on your screen and cast your vote before November 5th.
Nearly 19 million ballots have already been cast by early voters, and Donald Trump's encouragement may have something to do with the record-breaking turnout. The Republican presidential candidate has been urging his supporters to vote early and by mail. Trump previously came out against early voting and convinced his supporters to wait until Election Day to cast their ballots. In states where Democrat early turnout usually outnumber Republicans, the numbers are coming out in the GOP's favor. Even with a high Republican turnout, election experts say that Democrats still bank more early votes, and demographic trends in early voting can disappear once Election Day votes are factored in.
And a trial is around the corner for a Hyattsville woman charged with the murder of her own mother.
Mariah Jalad is at the county courthouse with more.
Well, jury selection is underway today in the trial of Candace Craig, accused of murdering, dismembering, and burning the body of her 71-year-old mother. You may remember the gruesome story from May of last year when authorities were called to Craig's home to do a welfare check on her mother, Margaret. When police arrived to the home, they were met with the smell of a decomposing body and found the victim dismembered in the basement. Craig allegedly used numerous utensils, knives to dismember the body, and tried to use a barbecue grill to burn and get rid of the evidence. She allegedly had her then 19-year-old daughter help her dispose of the remains. Court documents say the murder followed what's believed to be an argument over fraudulent credit card charges, with Margaret threatening to report her daughter Candace to the police. Now, Candace's daughter, Sawyer Hardy, is also charged in this case with accessory after the fact. Candace Craig faces first and second degree murder charges. Her trial will begin once jury selection is complete. From Upper Marlboro, I'm Mariah Jalad, CTV News.
Thank you, Mariah, for that report. And a program aimed at helping senior citizens in need in District 8 that helps take care of their landscaping is wrapping up for the season. Crews were at a house on the 8100 block of Alcoa Drive in Fort Washington. 550 seniors who need help tending to their lawns took part in the program this year. Council member Edward Burroughs says some seniors are in real need of the help.
Normally, they will come out, cut the grass. They might do some mulching. They might plant flowers depending on the situation. And then they come back every 2 weeks. With this situation, it needs a lot more support, and that's what we're finding, that some seniors who have not had the ability to afford someone to maintain their lawns, we have excessive growth and other issues that we have to attend to. But once that's done, we're able to then put them in the normal pipeline of getting their grass cut every 2 weeks.
Borough plans to bring back the initiative next year.
Well, Prince George's police have charged a suspect involved in a fatal shooting in Largo last month. 21-year-old Malik Watson, who you can see right there on your screen, is charged with first and second degree murder of 27-year-old Craig Rogers II. Now, the shooting happened at the 1000 block of Largo Center Drive on September 20th. Police found Rogers in the roadway suffering from gunshot wounds. He was later pronounced dead on the scene. Now, investigation shows that Rogers and Watson knew each other.
Police have also charged two suspects involved in a fatal shooting at a tire shop last month. Ronnell Hardy and Avril Eccles are both charged with first and second degree murder of 41-year-old Anthony Okoye. The shooting happened at the 1200 block of Maplewood Avenue on September 14th. Police found Okoye, an employee, suffering from gunshot wounds. He later died at a hospital. Investigation shows that Hardy and Eccles were customers who were arguing with Okoye over payment for tires before they shot him.
And we have an update to a story we brought to you yesterday about the mass food poisoning incident in Jessup that sent 46 people to the hospital. Now, seafood distributor NAFCO, the company at the center of the incident, says that the illness was linked to homemade food prepared by an employee over the weekend and shared with coworkers. Now, nearly 50 employees got sick after consuming the food during their lunch break. And NAFCO emphasizes that this was an isolated incident with no impact on its products or supply chain.
McDonald's Quarter Pounder burgers are at the center of an E. coli outbreak investigation. The CDC, FDA, and USDA are working with McDonald's after reports of illnesses in several states, primarily in Colorado and Nebraska, linked to the popular burger. Fresh slivered onions and beef patties used in the Quarter Pounder are being investigated as possible sources of contamination. As a precaution, McDonald's has temporarily stopped serving Quarter Pounders in several states, including Colorado, Kansas, and Utah.
The decision to do this is not one we take lightly, and it was made in close consultation with the CDC. It's important to note that the majority of states and the majority of menu items are not affected. Other beef products at McDonald's, including the cheeseburger, hamburger, Big Mac, McDouble, and the double cheeseburger, are not impacted. This is a temporary change as the investigation continues, and we are working quickly to return our full menu in these states as soon as possible.
McDonald's says safety remains their top priority as they work closely with health officials to resolve the issue.
A little matchmaking in the county council today, or at least that's the plan. At-large member Calvin Hawkins hosted a business roundtable town hall. It's aimed at small and minority-owned business owners, but the goal is to put the businesses in contact with agencies that are looking for services.
We talk about the school system, when we talk about parking planning, the community college, how we really keep these dollars in our community and how we really work with these small businesses to get them in a position where they can reap some of the benefits of these different opportunities opposed to continuously going in a different direction.
It's a great opportunity to find out what services and benefits are afforded to Prince George's County-based businesses, as well as to be able to share that vital information with other businesses.
And Hawkins says today's session is the first in a series of meetings he plans to hold. And you're watching CTV News. I'm Michaela Newton.
And I'm Katara Jones. Still to come, TSA is issuing a warning for travelers. Find out what you need to know before the busy holiday season.
I wish people knew that when you live in a small town like mine, it's much, much harder to find friends with common interests, especially ones my age. I often feel really alone.
Same here. Seems like every time we finally settle somewhere, I have to pack up and move again. By the time I make a friend, a real friend, I have to say goodbye to them.
I totally get it. I live in a big city, but it can feel just as lonely. It's tough, but it gets easier.
Honestly,
I totally get what you're going through.
It's nice to know that, like, you feel the same.
You enjoyed my story. I really enjoyed your story as well.
Welcome back. Attorney General Anthony Brown decides to not file charges in the fatal police-involved shooting in New Carrollton. Now, we want to warn our viewers at home that the video you are about to see might be disturbing. This announcement involves an incident where New Carrollton police officers shot Artel Cunningham back on January 30th. The Attorney General's Independent Investigations Division determined that none of the officers committed a crime under Maryland law. As we reported, New Carrollton officers were looking into an SUV that they found was recently reported stolen. Cunningham approached the officers and pulled out two guns. The officers shot Cunningham, and he died later at a hospital.
Well, schools must now share information about students charged with serious crimes after the Maryland State Board of Education passed an emergency rule change. This comes after school leaders in Howard County discovered a high school student was charged with murder and had been on electronic monitoring after being arrested in Anne Arundel County. Now, local school system superintendents must immediately inform the school principal and security officer of a student who has been arrested for a reportable offense, even if that happened off school grounds. Now, those charges could include murder, arson, armed carjacking, and sexual offenses, among others. The emergency rule change applies to any student currently enrolled in a Maryland school.
Visa is sounding the alarm on new and emerging scams in its State of Scams report. The report says that despite an $11 billion investment in security infrastructure, criminals are returning to basics, including a surge in small-scale physical theft and government impersonation scams. It also highlights threats such as digital pickpocketing and sophisticated phishing attacks targeting consumers, while also warning businesses about rising issues like gas station fraud and ransomware attacks on third-party providers.
Well, Bowie State University was buzzing with excitement this morning as super cybersecurity grandma Dr. Lois Palin took center stage at the Elementary Cybersecurity Olympic Competition. In honor of Cybersecurity Month, students faced off in three competitions while exploring 15 interactive cybersecurity exhibits. Now, schools from across the region competed in an all-day of fun and learning, all aimed at building future cybersecurity champions.
I'm trying to start early. I've been in business for 30 years working with middle and high school students. Now I'm reaching down lower to get elementary kids focused on STEM career, but mainly in the cybersecurity space.
I really am focusing on the fact that there are so many cybersecurity jobs that are available now. There are like 400,000 open cybersecurity jobs, and we need people for those opportunities. And I want to make sure that at a young age, these students learn, hear about these types of jobs on the technical side and on the non-technical side.
And Dr. Palin has been in the cybersecurity industry for over 20 years.
If you are preparing for your next getaway, TSA says don't forget to clear out your luggage before heading to the airport. So far this year, 38 firearms have been caught through security checkpoints at BWI Marshall Airport. Nationwide, TSA reports that more than 5,000 guns has been spotted at airport security checkpoints. Remember, firearms must be in a locked, hard-sided container as a checked bag, and the gun must be declared to the airline. Today, TSA showcased prohibited items like knives, large tools, and replicas of firearms or bullets that are not allowed on carry-on bags.
We have various knives that come through our checkpoint that are just prohibited to come in a carry-on bag. There's options. You can check your knife in the checked baggage, which is totally permissible, but do not bring that knife through our checkpoints. To be a firearm owner, please, you must know where your firearm is at all times. And I go back to an empty bag before you pack, before you come to the airport. If you clear that empty bag out, you're not going to have a firearm in that carry-on bag.
If you are unsure as to what is allowed at security checkpoints, visit tsa.gov.
And so to come on CTV News, home sales in Prince George's County are on the rise.
After the break, we speak to the president of the Prince George's County Association of Realtors to discuss the market's growth. Back in a moment.
My name's Stacy. I'm 57, and I was adopted in 2020.
We were adopted in 2019.
And we were adopted in 2021.
We had a house, and it sounds crazy, but it wasn't a home. The one thing that Jake and Emma brought is it became a home.
When I met Dakota, he had just turned 14.
You weren't there for the first this and the first that. I missed the first words, but we got a lot of other firsts.
Watching her say, oh my God, I cannot believe I got my license. And she's like, I passed. And I'm like, girl.
See them grow. It is.
They chose to love us. They didn't have to. They chose us. Family.
You and you.
Kids in the middle.
What I thought was a complete life was nowhere near complete. But it is now.
Learn about adopting a teen from foster care. You can't imagine the reward. Visit AdoptUSKids.org.
Got one of these hanging on the wall? You're qualified. One of these? You're qualified too. Love a good checklist? Qualified. 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 Yep, qualified.
Because if you know how to put up anything in your home,
you're qualified to save lives by installing free smoke alarms in your community. Go to soundthealarm.org to find a volunteer event near you.
Welcome back. We have an exciting update in the Prince George's County real estate market as home sales continue to surge. On October 1st, Arnita Green officially took over as president of the Prince George's County Association of Realtors.
Her leadership comes at a pivotal time as the latest market report shows a 14% increase in total home sales compared to last year. To discuss the market's continued growth and opportunities for buyers and sellers, we're joined by President Arnita Green. Thank you so much for having coming
Thank
on
you.
Today.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. So, you know, talk a little bit about what your top priorities are in this new leadership role.
So I want to tackle on a couple of things. One is legislative advocacy. Within Prince George's County, we do have major issues dealing with housing supply, rent control, and home affordability. So I definitely want to tackle that. Also, DEI, want to make sure that we are being inclusive to everybody within the real estate field, and just making sure that the public knows our value as realtors, that we're here to help them and to also be in a community and provide community leadership for everybody in the community.
Now, we always know that the real estate market is constantly changing,
yes.
But is it currently a buyer's or seller's market? And what should buyers or sellers look for in today's market?
So it's definitely still a seller's market, but buyers are out there looking. It's low inventory right now, so we definitely need more inventory on the market. But buyers are looking for the homes. They definitely want to be homeowners right now.
And you mentioned that DEI is an important topic, important for you to tackle in your leadership. Do you find that in the state of Maryland, the diversity among agents isn't there?
It's there, but we want to get more involved. They're there. We want to get more people to be involved and to be a part of what we have going on in the communities. So I just want to make sure that they know that we're out here for them, and that we want them to be a part of everything that we have going on.
Yes. Absolutely. And do you advise buyers or sellers to actually get an agent when they are pursuing homeownership or just buying their home?
Definitely. We're out here to advocate for our buyers and our sellers. We're there to educate. We're there to provide leadership for them, to make sure that we're for negotiating skills. Every part of the educational process of buying or selling a home, that's what we want them to know, that we're there to support and to make sure that we're there every step of the way for the process.
And when a buyer or seller decides not to go with an agent and then months later decides to go to an agent, talk a little bit about what they experience.
So I've experienced that. I mean, that sometimes buyers have buyer's remorse and that they wish that they would have used an agent, mainly that they didn't know something or the home inspection wasn't right or they had problems once they got into the home. And that's why we're here as realtors, to be there, a voice for the buyer and the seller, making sure that we are negotiating on their behalf, making sure that they, if they do a home inspection, that we're there to provide value for them and to make sure that whatever's wrong with the house, that we're there to make sure that it gets fixed. You know, so we're there to provide the value for a buyer and a seller and the education process.
Absolutely. So the average sold price in the county reached about $457,000 in September.
Yes.
But with mortgage rates, interest rates kind of dropping, do you foresee a change in the affordability of homes in the county?
Yeah. So one thing to realize is that is higher than it was last year, this time, September. So prices are going up, and that's why buyers are trying to get into the market now, which is smart, is to definitely get into the market now instead of waiting till later. I totally understand when people want to wait later, but now is the best time. One thing about it is always a good time to buy real estate.
And what's one thing you would tell a buyer who's ready to purchase their first home?
Oh, I would definitely tell them to seek professional advice first.
So don't ask your mom.
It's okay to ask your mom. Okay. That is okay, but you want to seek professional expertise when you are looking to buy a home. You want to contact a real estate agent, a professional real estate agent, to make sure that they're giving you the right advice and to hold your hand. Most of them, they need a lot of hold hand. And so you want to hold their hand through the whole process.
Absolutely. What are some programs that the county provides for first-time home buyers? Are there any?
Oh, yes, there are plenty. One is Pathway to Purchase. That is in that program. There are a multitude of different programs in that one specific program that people can use to use for their down payment assistance and their closing costs. And I've had many people use that program. Mm.
Well, thank you, Ms. Green, for coming on and talking a little bit about this today.
Thank you for having me.
And for more information on the Prince George's County Association of Realtors, visit pgcar.com. And stay tuned. After the break, Bryce Parker has our Wednesday sports page.
That's right, and he's talking college football plus a recap of the Caps game. Don't go anywhere.
We grew up together. We believed in something bigger than ourselves. The military took me to one side of the world and her to the other. And even though she was always the strong one, when we caught up years later, I found out she had fallen on some hard times. It was her call to make, but doing it together made all the difference.
When I see homeless vets on my route, I always think to myself, we both swore an oath to protect our way of life, to protect our community. With VA's hotline for homeless vets, I can get them connected with help. Help to get them back on their feet again.
VA's round-the-clock hotline can put veterans who are homeless in touch with the resources and support they earned through their military service. You have the power to help a veteran facing homelessness. Go to va.gov/homeless to print your wild cards. For veterans who are homeless or on the brink of homelessness, call 877-424-3838.
What's up, sports fans? We have a lot to get to today. We start with a big shout out to Bowie State football.
Not only did the Bulldogs dominate on the scoreboard this weekend after defeating Bluefield State, but they had three players earn CIAA weekly honors this week. Congratulations to redshirt freshman Kevin Taylor on being named quarterback of the week, sophomore Makai Robinson on being named offensive back of the week, and senior punter Justin Zavala on being named special teams player of the week. Up next, Bowie State will host conference foe Virginia Union this weekend at Bulldog Stadium. And to College Park, following the Terps' big win this weekend, they held a press conference. They held a press conference after hosting the USC Trojans. Coach Loxley and some of the Terrapins players spoke about what led to the win and what to expect during their road matchup against the Minnesota Golden Gophers this weekend.
I think they understand how important it is that we continue to stay focused on the process as well as the progress. And when you make small changes, they typically add up to big shifts. And I saw that, as I said Saturday, I saw our team grow up right before our eyes. I saw the younger players and I saw some of these guys that have had a tough go the last few weeks grow up. And that's what you want to see, incremental improvement every game. You know, excited about this opportunity against Minnesota on the road. As we know, it's always tough. As it's been highlighted, you know, every week you see teams really struggle when they go on the road in the Big Ten because it's a tough league. But I expect us to continue to put the work in this week, show up Saturday, continue to do the things we need to do to improve against a good team. And I know it's their homecoming, so it'll be a great crowd, a great environment that I know our players will be excited about.
Keep working in practice because a lot of things that happen in practice happens in the games, and we just got to keep working in practice to limit the big plays, and that's what will happen on Saturday.
We know going into every game, we know we're a good team, and it's just a matter we can't allow ourselves to beat ourselves. It's just a matter of what we do. So really, we just pay attention to the next game, whatever game that may be on our schedule. That's what we put our focus into.
The Terps are now two games back from first place in the conference. Into the ice we go. The Caps had an impressive performance last night against the Flyers. It started with defense turning into offense. Nick Dowd with the steal, racing down the ice, and when he gets that close, the defender just has to pray. Goalkeeper cannot do anything about that. The Caps go up 1-0. And shortly after, McMichael with a beautiful pass to Mangiapane, and Mangiapane with a shot to the upper left corner. And just like that, the Caps were up 2-0 before the Flyers could even blink. And in the third period, the icing on the cake is Chichern from distance, finds the back of the net, and that's all she wrote, ladies and gentlemen. Caps win 4-1. Here's Mangiapane after the game, after the big goal he had last night.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to get a kind of quick shot off. I saw, you know, a great play by Mikey. Like I said, and, you know, he found me with speed through the middle, and just kind of wanted to kind of get it off and, you know, get a quick release. So happy that it kind of went in, and it was a big goal for our team.
The Caps and the Flyers will face off again tonight at 7:30. And wrapping up sports, the Washington Mystics have fired their head coach and general manager today. Father and son duo Eric and Mike Thibault have been relieved of their duties. Mike has been the general manager of the team since retiring as head coach of the Mystics after the 2022 season. His son Eric took over immediately after as head coach. And we now have an update from the Commanders practice field as quarterback Jaden Daniels did not suit up for practice today following the rib injury he sustained Sunday against the Carolina Panthers. Now, head coach Dan Quinn is optimistic that Daniels will return to the practice field soon, but if soon means tomorrow, Friday, or next week remains unknown. And that is our Wednesday sports page.
All right, Bryce, thanks so much. Well, let's get a look at our three-day forecast. Tonight will be partly cloudy. Tomorrow will be sunny. We're looking at a high of 66 and a low of 41.
Friday will have a clear skies and will reach a high of 68. Saturday will be mostly sunny with a high of 71 and a low of 43.
And for our community calendar, listen up. Tomorrow and Friday night, global icon Diana Ross will be performing at the MGM National Harbor.
Ross rose to stardom in the 1960s as the leader of the Motown girl group, The Supremes, and went on to have a successful solo singing career and acting career. Showtime starts at 8 p.m. For more tickets and more information, visit mgmnationalharbor.com.
All right, well, that's all the time we have for CTV News. Thanks so much for joining us.
We'll see you again tomorrow. Good night.
Good night, everybody.